Welcome everyone to the second event of the Ashoka Crossover Series, a program of conversations and lectures organized by Ashoka University in the lead up to its opening in August 2014, not very far away now. The key word in the series title is crossover, and our program crosses over in at least two ways. First of all, the program is crossing the divide between the public and the academic. What we're trying to do here is introduce audiences to some of the most interesting, startling, and innovative ideas in contemporary scholarship. But we're also trying to cross over in another way. We're trying to bridge the divide between disciplines normally regarded as completely separate. How, for instance, might a work of literature ask questions normally broached by sociologists, psychologists, even physicists? Crossing over is something that Ashoka University is fully committed to. It's a four-year multidisciplinary university. It will be in Kundli, just 25 minutes north of Delhi University. And we're committed to producing students who value critical thought. And by critical thought, we mean the ability to ask questions that range widely, deeply across disciplines, making connections between arts, social sciences, and pure sciences. Our speaker tonight, who we're very honored to have today, Shri Gopalkrishna Gandhi, embodies what it means to cross over. He did his BA and MA in English from St. Stephen's here in Delhi, but he has spent a life in service, most notably as governor of West Bengal between 2004 and 2009. Even as a public servant, he has notably led a life of the mind, publishing a series of books that themselves cross over between various disciplines. He's the author, amongst other books, of Gandhi in South Africa, Gandhi in Sri Lanka, Nehru in Sri Lanka, but he's also a novelist. And he crosses over, too, in the forms that he writes in. He has written a play in verse about Dara Shikoh, himself something of a crossover figure, the syncretic Mughal prince who attempted to bridge the divide between Hinduism, Islam, and various other religious systems. Shri Gandhi's work crosses over at the level of language. He has done a translation of Vikram Seth's A Suitable Boy, translated as Koi Acha Sa Larka. I'll be interested to find out if he will translate Vikram Seth's forthcoming A Suitable Girl. but also, his work has crossed over in really intriguing ways in terms of his own background. He embodies what it means to be an Indian crossover, in as much as he is the scion of a Gujarati family, but also of a Tamil family. And last but not least, his work embodies what it means to cross over between different ideas of India. And that's what we're going to be listening to today. The talk is called Different Words, India, Hindustan, and Bharat. India is not one, but multiple. How do we reconcile these very different ideas of India? So I want you to join me in welcoming Shri Gopalkrishna Gandhi to the stage now as our second crossover speaker.
Well, I'm honored to be here, dismayed by the introduction, and rather worried about this connection of me with crossing over. I was very admiring of that phrase, crossover, crossover talks, crossover lectures, the concept of a kind of fluency and fluidity between disciplines and between venues, spatial venues, imaginational venues. But there's also something very there's some suggestion or a touch of instinct suggestibility about crossing over, some slight inconsistency also, a kind of tentativeness about crossing over. So if I was told I symbolize crossing over, I would think whether that is really a compliment. I am not very sure. But let me not get trapped into this description of crossing over in its application to me and come straight to the subject. I was thinking of what might interest a group of this kind from a speaker of my kind. And I thought, essentially a very young group like this is, would like to know from somebody who is as old as I am, what being an Indian has meant. And I thought I'll start by reversing the sequence of this evening's program, in which a lecture is followed by questions, by asking a couple of questions, not too many, a couple of questions of all of you, before I give you a sense of what I've been thinking about this subject. And if that is all right by you, I would like to just ask, you do not have to speak in terms of mobility and crossing over. You could just forget that for a moment and just respond as you may wish to respond to some of these thoughts, which are really speculative rather than inquisitive. All of you come from different parts of India. You've grown in a generation in which India has been changing very fast. And if you were to step back from whatever you are doing, to think of what India means to you, first of all, politically, would you think of it in terms of Bharat? And if so, what would Bharat mean? I just want to know that, because as you know, the Constitution of India starts with the first word is India. India, that is Bharat. So I just want to know whether you think of India as Bharat, and if so, what Bharat means. Just like to have a sample of your thoughts before I suggest some thoughts of my own to you. So anyone, please. We do not need a roving mic. I think we'd be audible even without that.
So when you say India, that is Bharat, I think the first thought that comes into my mind is of civilizational continuity. When you talk in terms of Bharat coming and still rejuvenating itself in the modern terms as it is known as India. Therefore, continuity to me would be the thought that comes across.
It's very interesting. So when you think of Bharat, you think of, you get a sense of panoramic continuity, a kind of epic scale of India which is coming down time. Okay, that's very interesting. Any other, either corroborating or differing from this?
So my views don't agree with what was just voiced. When I think of the term Bharat, I think of an idea that's almost mythical, because what I perceive as Bharat or the associations that I have with it are of very, very long ago, and I think the idea of Bharat and the idea of India are two very separate, maybe political or cultural entities for me.
Now that's fascinating. That is exactly what I would like to dwell on, and perhaps with your help, understand myself a bit better. Can I request a third perspective on Bharat before I move on? A third perspective. It need not be a different perspective. It could be similar, but still a third.
I I think it's a matter of linguistic convenience, because it's very hard to say main ek India vasi hoon, but we can always say main ek Bharat vasi hoon. So it's very hard for, I think, a population to identify with the concept of a nation that is not part of its language itself.
All right. Thank you very much. Now, one final indulgent, self-indulgent request. Do you think Bharat as a second thought, as a second remove, as an embellishment, a translation of what is naturally in your mind the name of the country, which is India? Or do you think of it the other way around? Do you think India is the globally understood name of what is for you Bharat? Does, in other words, the name of the country strike you as India, or does it strike you as Bharat? Thank you. Now, let me say there is great truth in all the four responses. And I'll suggest to you reasons why I think there is great truth in them. A little historical exegesis is always very useful. In the Constituent Assembly, this was the subject of very animated discussion. In November 1948, in fact, almost to the date, today is the 13th, right, or 12th? 12th. On the 17th of November 1948, this particular first opening sentence was taken up for discussion. India, that is Bharat, shall be a union of states. Now, Nehru was the chairman of the Union Constitution Committee. Dr. Ambedkar was the chairman of the Drafting Committee. This was their formulation, India, that is Bharat. But there were many in the Constituent Assembly who said, what is this India, that is Bharat? We have become free. If anything at all, it should be Bharat, that is India, shall be Union of States. And many people got into this discussion. And some of the things which some of you said today, there is a sense of continuity, there is a sense of history. Pandit Kamalapati Tripathi of Banaras, a Sanskritist, he said, the name Bharat resounds in our subconscious mind, and when I say Bharat, I can hear the twang of Sri Rama's bow, and I want that to have precedence over some name given to us by the Greeks, India. Shibbanlal Saxena, another member of the Constituent Assembly, said very similar things. Sir Govindas, another member of the Constituent Assembly, said very different things. And then Dr. Ambedkar got up and looked at the chair and said, sir, is all this necessary? His exact words. Is all this necessary? We have a lot of work to do. These are his exact words. To expand on his words, he was saying, why are we quibbling about words? The original constitution is being drafted in English. It is going to be translated into all the languages of India, but it is going to be translated. Its basic template is going to be English. India, that is Bharat, serves the purpose very well. Debate continued. H.V. Kamath, another very distinguished member, said, no, this is not right. We have work to do. He has work to do. He says, we are all in the same work. Mr. Chairman, then he looked at Dr. Rajendra Prasad in the chair. Are you going to decide what is work, or is Dr. Ambedkar going to decide what is work? Dr. Ambedkar was silent. Then Chairman President Prasad said, all right, Mr. Kamath, you move an amendment. India, that is Bharat, should become Bharat, that is India. Then somebody said, we are forgetting another name, Hindustan. So debate extended. Then the chairman said, either Hindustan or Bharat, one of the two, not both, give us an amendment. It was put to vote by 38 in favor of Bharat, that is India, and 51 for India, that is Bharat. By 13 votes, we became India, that is Bharat. And speaking for myself, thank God we are India, that is Bharat. And I will tell you why. You may not agree with me, but I think I will tell you why. We have our national emblem. We are the only country in the world, I think, which has three names for the country. Popular names. Officially, India, that is Bharat, two, and Hindustan, which is very current, third. We are probably also the only country in the world which has a national anthem and a national song. National anthem being what it is, national song being Vande Mataram. I don't think any other country has this formula. And we have a third, like Hindustan is not an official name, but a popular name. We have a third, Tarana Hind, Sare Jahan Se Achha, which has not been given the status of national song, but it is there lurking in the wings. So we have a national anthem, we have a national song, and we have in the Tarana Hind, in Sare Jahan Se Achha, an eternal alternative to both. And we have the national emblem. The national emblem has, can any of you tell me in very simple description, which all of you know, I know all of you know what the national emblem is. I just want a very simple description of the national emblem from any one of you. Congratulations 100 times and thank you. Did you say four lions? Yeah, absolutely right. I'm astonished that you said. If I had been asked, not just when I was as young as you are, but even more recently before I put my mind to this subject, how many lions, I would have said three lions. But there is actually a fourth. The fourth is not seen. It's not visible. There is a fourth lion. Now, what is he doing? Okay. Our national flag is also popularly called the tricolor, right? Tiranga. Vishwa Vijayi Tiranga Pyara. But actually, it has four colors. The chakra, which is blue, is taken for granted. The three colors, horizontal, are taken as the three colors, tricolor, tiranga. But there's the fourth. And it is blue. Now, what does all this have to do with Bharat and Hindustan? Everything. Somebody has said that the Constituent Assembly of India gave us a constitution, which is a work of the honest for the innocent. There is something in that. Honesty and innocence are both slightly in decline. But there is something in this. And I would say, when we think of Bharat and Hindustan and India, we should remember the fact that there is an invisible fourth lion, an under-recognized fourth color. And really, in the description of India, that is Bharat, a great obfuscation of several truths of India. And when we say Bharat, we think of the country with pride, a kind of self-pride, which is nudging jingoism. When we say India, we do not quite have the same sense. But Hindustan is the Cinderella of all these names. And I feel very, very sad to see that Hindustan is in great neglect, whereas Bharat is not. Bharat is the name of India which has a trumpet blowing in it. India is India, a simple name. And very often, as you, sir, said, it's a nomenclature matter. People find it easy to say Bharat. They could also You can say Bharat Vasi, you can't say India Vasi, true. But one should also remember the fact that the sound of the trumpet is a very heartland sound. There are many parts of India which would not find any resonance to the description of Bharat, of India as Bharat. The Hindi-speaking part of India, which is only a part of India, albeit a large part of India, would be very comfortable with saying, "Hum Bharat Vasi hai." But the large part of India that is outside the Hindi belt, the south, the northeast, Lakshadweep, Andamans, they're much more comfortable with India than with Bharat. And we must find out why. I do not think anyone in the northeast would like to say, "I am a Bharatvasi." They're no less patriotic than anyone who says, "I am a Bharatvasi." They're much more happy to say, "We are Indian." And they probably will even say that in English. And we must find out why. And this is where Dr. B.R. Ambedkar had a point which Pandit Kamalapati Tripathi, Shibhanlal Saxena, and Seth Govindas were all missing. He was speaking for the fourth lion. He was speaking for the unacknowledged fourth color, the Ashoka Chakra in blue. And he was speaking for all those fellow citizens who would not resonate to the word Bharat. But he was at the same time conceding the fact that due to the epic and historical continuity of Bharat, we must have an Indian equivalent for India, and that is Bharat. I would like to shift the discussion to Hindustan. But before I do that, let me share with you a couple of thoughts on our national anthem. Just as we have obfuscated the fourth color on the flag, and we have all but forgotten, which is why I'm so glad and grateful that you remembered the fourth lion on the emblem. We do not know that the national anthem that we sing, a great work, is an abridged form of the full song. The full song was too large to be a national anthem. One good reason for it not to be the national anthem, a full song. Another good reason for it not to be the national anthem, for the full song not to be the national anthem, is that how can you remember such a long song to sing when children are singing, and when bands are playing, it needs a crisp version. And so, snip, snip, abridge. But what is abridged? The inconvenient is abridged. Not the superfluous, but the inconvenient. Janaganamana, written in 1913 by Rabindranath Tagore, has the most beautiful lines, which we do not sing, which is not part of the official version of the national anthem, which go like this. How many of you know Bangla? Why, a big percentage. You know all this, you know the anthem. But towards the end come these lines. Does anybody know the lines, the expurgated lines? You do. Okay. Then maybe I should request you to sing it. I'll just speak it, and then maybe you could sing it. The lines are, "Ghora timira ghana, ghora timira ghana, nibira nishide, ghora timira ghana, dark, dense, ghora timira." You can imagine Tagore's vivid imagination. "Ghora timira ghana, nibira nishide, at night, pidito murchita deshe, agonized, comatose country, pirita murchita deshe, duswapne, stricken with nightmares, duswapne, atanke, terrorized, and then an appeal, rokha korile anke, protect me, snehamoi tumi mata, affectionate mother, protect me. Now, we can't have this in a national anthem, can we? But we can have it at the back of our minds as what comprised the vision of Rabindranath Tagore. Now, snip, snip, scissors have worked on the national anthem. Ghora timira ghana nibira nishide, peedita murchita deshe, duswapne, atanke, rokha korile anke, snehamoi tumi mata. Now, I'm glad this is not in the national anthem. And I'm glad this, the abridged version, is our national anthem. But we cannot afford to forget that there is an India that Tagore knew, which he acknowledged, which was a vulnerable India, a stricken, comatose India, which wanted protection. Now, has that India gone away? This is the great point. The national song is also an abridged version of the fuller song. Those who have studied the history of Vande Mataram know why it was abridged. And thank God it was abridged. But what remains, of course, is a beautiful song. But then, Sare Jahan Se Achha, Iqbal's great composition, has not been abridged anywhere because it has not been made official anywhere. But before I go into Sare Jahan Se Achha, may I ask you to recite the abridged version, the excised portion. Will you sing it for us?
Sir, I actually don't know the tune, and then my Bengali is not perfect. So
it is better than mine.
No, sir, but the only thing that I know, there's a third paragraph of Vande Mataram.
Vande Mataram?
Yeah.
We are on the national anthem.
Yeah, so that's exactly why I'm not too sure about the national anthem.
So you were thinking of Vande Mataram?
No, I know the part of the national anthem, but I'm not confident about my pronunciation.
Okay. Now that's fine. But you know it, that's a big thing. Most of us don't. Now, Sare Jahan Se Achha. You know the national anthem? Can you, which I said?
Not that one. I've learned all the five, but I've forgotten all of it.
Can we hear it from you, please? Can we hear it from you?
Yeah, I would not want to sing it, but the second paragraph, if I'm not wrong, goes like, Aharah tav avhana pracharata sunita vaudara vani, tumi chira sarathi tavarata chakare. I'm forgetting.
No, that's wonderful.
It goes
that's
like
wonderful.
That.
And then you see, this is towards the end, and then there's a great mood swing. The national anthem has a huge mood swing. It's a great composition, not because it's patriotic alone, which it is, but also because it is very human. It has mood swings like India has mood swings. The last para is very optimistic. Rabindranath says, I can't end the song on a pessimistic note. So I'll give it an optimist. And then he says, Ratri Prabhatilo Udilo Robichubi. Ratri Prabhatilo is after the night. There is the dawn. Ratri Prabhatilo Udilo Robichubi Purva Udayagiri Bhali. On the mountains of the east rises the sun. And there is a little authorial ego, a little touch. Robi Chobi, Robi is a pun on his own name. So he is also rising in the sun. But that is a poetic conceit. That's lovely. Thank you very much. So we have this mood swings of India. But to come back to Sare Jahan Se Achha, which is about Hindustan. Sare Jahan Se Achha Hindustan Hamara. Most of us know that. We also know that much quoted convenient line, Mazhab Nahi Sikhata, Aapas Mein Bair Rakhna. Can somebody complete it for me? Anyone? Mazhab Nahi Sikhata. Can somebody complete that couplet for me?
Hindi hai hum watan hai, Hindustan hamara.
Wonderful, that's right. Now, Hindi hai hum watan hai Hindustan hamara. But there is a very little known line in Tarana-e-Hind in which Iqbal says, with, from the depths of his heart, Iqbal koi mahram apna nahi jahan mein. Iqbal koi mahram apna nahi jahan mein. Maloom kya kisi ko darde niha hamara. Who knows the dard that lies within us? Now, who is hamara in Iqbal's song? Somebody would say superficially, he is talking of the Islamic qaum. He may be, but that is not all. It was Tarana-e-Hind. And he had said, Mazhab nahi sikhata aapas mein bair karna. So I would say, Iqbal was talking about the Hind jiske andar dard hai. Tagore was talking about ghor timir ghana nibira nishide. Now, these two are trumpeted out of Bharat, is my view. I have nothing against the name Bharat. But Bharat is stentorian. It is triumphal. It is the name that our country must have in the first line of the Constitution. And I'm all for it. But there is another side to India which is trumpeted out. And that is what Iqbal has sung about, what Rabindranath has sung about. Iqbal in that part of the Tarana-e-Hind which we do not remember, Rabindranath in that part of the anthem which has been abridged out. And so, crossovers. We must continuously in our mind, as we remind ourselves of our citizenship, remember that Dr. B.R. Ambedkar brought in the word Bharat, but he said India, that is Bharat, with good reason, because he felt that this country is not about triumphalism alone, but it is about realism. And that realism is personified by India, the name by which South India, East India, Northeast India, littoral India, coastal India, desert India, forest India will know India, not by those who will resound to the triumph and to the trumpet. I love films. And I must share with you a little piece of interesting statistic which I had gathered not very long ago, which is this, that in the early years of our filmmaking post-independence, the number of films that had Bharat and Hindustan depended on when they were made. People of my generation remember the film Kismat with the lines Dur hato ye dunya walo Hindustan hamara hai. And in globalizing times, if we were to say Dur hato dunya walo, we'd sound very odd. But that was a work of Pradeep and his lyrics from the film Jagriti. Aao bachcho hame dikhayen jhaanki Hindustan ki. So Hindustan was very strong in the earlier era. Very strong indeed. Prior to that, during the independence movement, when we were wanting self-assertion, Bharat was very strong in Indian cinema. There was Veer Bharat in the 24-34, Nav Bharat, Bharat Ka Lal, Jai Bharat, Bharat Ki Beti, Bharat Ki Sati, all in the 20s and 30s. But in the 40s and early 50s, it was Hindustan. And later on, curiously, as the 50s petered into the 60s, India came in with the story of India, Miss India, Mother India, and may I mention it, Oh Darling, Ye Hai India, with the song, I Love My India. Now there is a great, I would say, corporate upper middle class, mobile Indian middle class bonding between I love my India and Mera Bharat Mahan. Now, I have no problems with anybody loving India. I love my India too, and I think Mera Bharat is rather Mahan. But between the Mahanata of Bharat, the Ekta of Hind or Hindustan, and the Samata of India, there is a great mismatch. And we must be aware of the crossovers between the Mahanata, Ekta, and Samata. And unless we remember that, we will get trapped into an incomplete India. None of these three is wrong, but each of these three is incomplete. And that is what we must try to remember. And I'd like to conclude my comments before we go into a discussion with what President K.R. Narayanan, with whom I was privileged to work, said in his Republic Day address shortly before he gave up office. He said in his Republic Day address, and this is the President of India speaking with all the three colors plus chakra and the emblem with the fourth line invisible, the President of India speaking. He said, beware of the anger of the patient man. Beware of the anger of the patient man. It is the anger of the patient man which is embedded in the fourth lion, in the unrecognized chakra, and in the two excised portions of the songs that I mentioned. And if that is the missing link in your conceptions of what all of you are going to do as you plan to be leaders, and I understand leadership is a kind of ideal for all of you, and if you keep that in mind, it will be the better for you and the better for those who you will be leading. And now for those who have not got into the deepest slumber, I offer my thanks and invite your questions. I could continue from here.
Hello, sir. Hi. You spoke about how Bharat, how people south don't connect. But one thing I find very peculiar is only time I was probably exposed to Bharat is probably when I read literature in school or something, when this concept mentioned of Bharat and Nadu, or the whole concept of Bharat, which is only in patriotic literature you find. Was it also probably given only during the time of independence, the later times of independence, and that wasn't common for in Tamil or any other South Indian languages?
Thank you for that question. I think India is one country where you can't generalize. The moment you make any comment about India, you will immediately find an exception, and a very valid exception. So if I were to say that Bharat is a sort of Hindi hinterland word, does not apply to the south, I would not be right. Because Bharat and Nadu is a very good normal expression for India. And the greatest national poet, as we call him, of South India was Subramanya Bharati. Now, having said that, it's always good in India, about India, when you want to make a general comment, start with the exception and then come to the generalization. If you were to make a generalization, then you would be immediately told there are exceptions to this, you are wrong. But if you start with the exception, say there are exceptions, this is the exception, but broadly this is the generalization that can be made, which is exactly what Dr. Ambedkar did when he said India, that is Bharat. Now, I would say that all these three names, four names in fact, were used during the national movement. Gandhi wrote his first book in the shape of a book in 1909, and he called it Hind Swaraj. There was Hind. 1909. In 1919, he started his journal in English called Young India. 1942, Quit India Movement in English, in Hindi was called Bharat Chodo. So all three were utilized. Now what does this mean? That the national movement incorporated all the strands of India's nationalism, co-opted them, if you say, if you will, into the cause. So all three were used. This was very deft. It was very necessary because none of them was false and each one of them was right. But opportunities are contextual. Crossovers, to use your phrase, cannot be a random rabbit warren running from here to there. It has to be done with some method, and that was definitely employed. Now the Hindustan Times was a nationalist newspaper. Now Bharat Times was a nationalist newspaper. The Times of India can't be called a nationalist newspaper, but then it was a nationwide newspaper. So all three were used. We must be aware of the multiplicity of our identities and use them for the larger and collective good, but never allow one to dominate the other. To go back once to your question, Sardar Bhagat Singh, Shaheed Bhagat Singh, his organization is called the Hindustan Republican Association of India. And it is said that his last words on the scaffold were in Kalabi, Zindabad, Hindustan, Zindabad.
So I noticed that you mentioned the Ekta of Hindustan, and following that observation, I was just wondering how you would respond to the fact that Hindustan at present seems to constantly be invoked as some sort of political tool that is largely exclusionary, especially by right-wing political parties as of now. I mean, Hindustan or the concept of Hindustan as India isn't something that I really associate with unity as much as I do with something that is invoked superficially only so that I may have an India of, you know, Hindustan as is derived from Hindus. As long as that characterization, maybe it was present. So I was just wondering what your views on that would be, especially because you said Hindustan for you is associated with Ekta.
Thank you. Just as one can't generalize about India without attracting exceptions, India is full of ironies. You know, we have the great Navarasas, Shingara, Bhakti, etc., etc. I don't even know what they are. But irony is not one of the rasas that is mentioned. But irony is one of the greatest truths of India. Hindustan and Hind, right? Azad Hind Fauj of Netaji Subhash Bose. Hind and Hindustan are used in Urdu more than in non-Urdu Hindi, used in Hindustani. Hindustani itself as a language has gone out of vogue, which is a great pity according to me. But the word Hindustan is associated in a hasty interpretation with Hindus. The word Hindustan and Hind come from the river Sindhu, which has been extrapolated to describe the large majority of the people of India who happen to have their faiths derived from the Vedas and the Upanishads. But it really has nothing to do with Hinduism as Hindutva may want to see it. So Hind and Hindustan, despite the fallacious ascription of the word Hind and Hindu to the people of a certain faith, is really a Hindustani word. And which is why I think, like the language Hindustani stands for Ekta, because Hindustani was an amalgamated language. It was not a purified language. It was not the Urdu that has become Persian, nor the Hindi that has become Sanskrit. I should be able to say both Prayag and Allahabad with equal facility, depending on the context. And in fact, I should be able to say कि मैं प्रयाग का इस्तेमाल भी कर सकता हूँ और इलाहाबाद का प्रयोग भी कर सकता हूँ. Should be able to say both. And that depends on the context. And it is extraordinary that people have stopped doing that. There are people, purists, who just say Prayag, would say Kashi, not say Banaras. Ustad Bismillah Khan, I asked him once when I was privileged to see him, I said, Khan Sahib, aapka sabse priya ras kya hai? He was a great rasas. He said, mera sabse priya ras, bhai, mera to sabse priya ras Banaras. So you can say Varanasi. You can say Varanasi. There's nothing wrong. But don't forget Banaras. That Banaras in Varanasi is the fourth lion. The Banaras in Varanasi is the Ashoka Chakra. Hindustani as a language is a language which we have lost. And I will tell you, you most of you know Hindustani. There is, my Hindi is very sort of, what shall I say, workman-like Hindi with no beauty to it. And you will pardon the sartorial commonplaceness of this story. But I went to the gentleman who has been stitching clothes for me, Siddiqui Sahib, and I asked him to stitch some kurta pajama for me. And I said, when Siddiqui Sahib, jab aap pajama banayenge, usme dekhiye jo nada hota hai, bahut lamba banayega, kyunki nada hamesha wo mori mein ghus jata hai. Lamba nada banayega. So he said, Huzoor, आप बेफिक्र रहिए, इजार बंद में, हमेशा इजार बंद, नेफ़े में गुम हो जाता है, मैं वैसा नहीं होने दूंगा. So I said, सिद्दीकी साहब, मुझे माफ करिएगा, नाड़ा कहाँ, मोरी कहाँ, इजार बंद कहाँ, नेफा कहाँ, आप माफ करिएगा. That culture has gone. We are in a very, shall I say, commonplace Hindi, which is not the same as simple Hindi. You must remember, there's a great difference between simplicity and clumsiness. What is clumsy and shabby is not simple. Slang is not simple. It is clumsy. Yes?
In your lecture so far, I found some indirect reference to a problem that comes when a civilizational idea is given a form of a nation state. Now, for example, a civilization can remain in terms of ideas. It can have some inherent contradictions. Yeah. It can borrow from a lot of things. But nation state, by the definition itself, they're slightly uncomfortable with the idea of plurality. And that is why one of the reasons may be that certain portions of national anthem were abridged. Because nations have a problem when there are multiplicity of identities in terms of construction. Would that interpretation be correct?
I get what you mean, sir. But I would say this. Consciousness of India's civilizational tapestry is very important. But a kind of arrogance about it is very wrong. We should be aware that India has a civilizational past. But we should also be aware of the fact that the geopolitical boundaries of an India that is a political entity is a contemporary and pragmatic detail of a cartographic dimension in a larger civilizational cartography, which has nothing to do with states, but everything to do with states of being, which is what India is. And which is why a great film like Nimal Roy's Kabuliwala, which was made in the story by Rabindranath again, has this character, the dry fruit seller, the Pathan, who when he sings in that film about his Vatan, we can all feel that he's talking about our Vatan. And that is because in that song, it's a great song, and it is not Tagore's song, incidentally. Tagore did not have that song in his story. When he talks about the mother, he talks about the daughter. And so we come back to the question, and this is how I would like to round off. A civilization is about people. A nation is about land, which holds people. A civilization is about people who are held by values. A nation is about land that holds people. But if that nation holds people who hold values, then the nation and the civilization crossover can take place. But if the nation is holding people by ideological force to make that nation monocultural, non-valuational, non-ideational, fascist, communalist, and also very often blindly and unthinkingly state communist, then we are in for trouble. But I do believe that our country, with its huge diversities, is never going to fall into that trap. Because our country is one in which we can have a national anthem, and periodically we can have a rather old man coming and telling a very young audience about what has been abridged and excised from that national anthem. Shall I take one more question?
You ended off with giving us some sort of advice, even though indirectly, about the patient man. And everything that you said about simplicity turning into shabbiness very easily and not being noticed, and the debate that you mentioned before, it's making me wonder that the thought that came into my head is when you fight for something, you're more careful about it. And the further we get away from the time that we fought for our country, the more the simplicity is turning into shabbiness, the more the debate is turning into debate for debate's sake. And maybe the lion, if you choose to selectively not see it, you're still giving it some importance. But when it lies forgotten is when you're really, really moving very far from the point that you started. So the fact that we have to come to a lecture to even think about things like what our country's names mean, how many names there are, and to actually realize after 21 years of our life that we do not know our national anthem originally, do you think we've come really far from there? Do you think there's ever a point of going back to the India that we're talking about, the Bharat, the India that was Bharat?
Well, India that is Bharat really is what the line in the constitution says. It's in the present continuous, to speak in grammatical lingo. And I think maybe your question, or maybe what you didn't intend to really say, but you said it, India that was Bharat. And perhaps, who knows, Dr. Ambedkar may really have thought of that when he said that the sentence should be India that is Bharat. He wanted to move away from an India that was Bharat. He wanted to be in India that is Nava Bharat. You know, that is something new, which is keeping the name, but which is going to infuse new life into it. And it's very likely that what you say is right, because he was thinking of those who have rage, who have reason to have rage, who have reason to be angry, but who must subsume their rage and anger into a solution. Because he did not want anybody to wallow in rage, and he did not want to perpetuate a system in which there could be rage. But I think you may well be right. I think it's very likely that among the many thoughts in his mind, and he, as he said, he had work to do. And we must remember that he was chairman of the drafting committee, and as chairman of the drafting committee, he was thinking of the whole of India. He was not thinking of a section of India. He was thinking and planning for the whole of India, thinking big for the whole of India, whereas others were wanting to think very small for their bits and pieces of India. And that is what we have to really go away with.
Sir, I needed to ask, it's very much in line with Nina's question, that identity is a rather complicated thing because it does not exclusively depend on us, because we are constantly viewed by the external world also. So India could think of itself as something, the world outside India, the countries that are not India, could think of India as something else, and both these views could be very different from what the world thinks that India thinks of itself, right? So at the end of the day, what changes and how much when there will always be an external world that looks at us? So because you can really change the way you look at yourself, but can you change the way you want to be looked at?
I'm not very sure if I got the full ramification of your question, but I think I've got a hang of it. To go back to the national movement, there was always a very strong dimension of the international context in our national movement. We were always very conscious of what the world was thinking of the national movement. And there were, of course, many manifestations of Indian nationalism abroad, like in the other movement in North America, and later the India League in Britain. And there were sporadic Indian nationalists in Japan. So we were very conscious of what the world is thinking of us. But it is true that we were then and we are now interested in the world when the world is convenient for us. And we are not interested in the world when the world has its own problems. Nehru was one extraordinary exception to this. He did rush to help other people, other countries, other societies in distress. And when he failed to do so, there were people in India who would remind him that he should be doing so, like Jayaprakash Narayan. When Jayaprakash Narayan found that India's position on Hungary vis-a-vis the Soviet Union was indefensible, he made it a point to say that, and the point was, what will the world think of India? If India does not speak up for the people of Hungary, what will the world think of us? Before that, Spain, we had participated in, Nehru had gone, Krishnamenon had gone. Now, I think, in our globalized times, we only think of the world in terms of, through corporate eyes. Basically, it's just that. We do not have a fierce interest in what is happening in other parts of the world, particularly in Africa, say, in Africa. I would not, if you were to ask me to name the countries of Africa, I would get very poor marks. I may get 50% marks in the names of countries. There are also some countries that have got divided and split and partitions. We are not really as interested in the world as we would like the world to be interested in us, especially commercially and economically and industrially and technologically. That is a big lack in us. And that is, I think, a very 19th century, 20th century, 21st century matter. In the earlier eras, were not like that. From what we know of history, it was not like that. When Ashoka sent his daughter and son with a sapling to Sri Lanka, to Ceylon as it was then, or Lanka as it was then, he was thinking of that country as much as his own. But we have stopped. We are actually a very insular people with rather narrow ambitions outside our country for our own benefit. We have ceased to be what we were, I think, in the late 40s and early 50s, a country which was known for its interest in Africa, in Asia, East Asia, and Latin America. A final question, perhaps.
And I prefer to speak.
Now you switched it off.
Hello? Yeah. Okay, so when I first started listening to you, I was actually quite indifferent because I thought it was very esoteric. And then a couple of statements in between actually jogged various emotions. Most of them were actually angst and anger. And the reason I'm saying this is because when we talk about the trumpeting out of Bharat and Hindustan and things like that, I feel that they are more veneers that we hide behind because these are all our past laurels that we love to believe. I don't know much about history because there's nothing I can be sure of because everything that I studied in school, I can't be sure of today because I don't know if it was accurate. I don't know if it's been saffronized. I don't know if it's just become a doctrine. When we go out today, we talk about who we are and who we are as a nation. Or I think what we need to actually figure out is whether we are a nation. If we are a nation, then there is a certain cohesiveness about that thing. I don't see that cohesiveness outside. I don't see the cohesiveness where I work. I don't see the cohesiveness when I travel. So all this pussyfooting around about everything, I want to go back then to Tagore's nightmare-filled night and Iqbal's pain and everything. Should we just not forget it? Should we just not ignore it? Or is that where our focus needs to be? It's so easy for us to feel really great as Indians. It's so easy for us to say, you know, the Indian cricket team, which one of us has ever contributed to the cricket team? We love our laurels, but is it true that we actually deserve them? And are we earning them today? And that's something that I think we need to ask ourselves. So the esoteria and the convenience of our wonderful national anthem or that I was forced to learn when I was in school, of the history that I was forced to learn when I was in school, it didn't have any relevance in Bangalore where I grew up. So where is the relevance to everyone? Can we actually think as a nation? Or do we actually need to think that without chauvinism? The South thinks of the North is one way, the North thinks of the South is one way. We might as well just be, you know, a closet courier. So is that the truth?
I think the very fact that you're asking this question is important. Because you're not asking this question to diminish the concept of India. And I hesitate to use the word idea of India because it has now become a cliche. And I abhor cliches. So you're not asking this question to diminish the concept of India. But you're asking this question from within the reality of India. And you want to know whether India is a nation. Now, that is a civilizational question. And it's very good that we should all ask this question. But we should also be aware that almost every nation asks this question. There is some questions which Australia need not ask of itself. Australia is the only island which is a country and a continent, and it has one minuscule minority community which the world is thinking about and is reminding Australia about. It doesn't have this angst. But most countries in the world, even a small country like Sri Lanka, has this problem. Are we a country? The people in the north of Sri Lanka do not think of Sri Lanka as the people in Batticaloa think of Sri Lanka. So where is the doubt that people in, children in Bangalore who are required to sing the national anthem will sing it with some puzzlement rather than with identification. But it is also true, and this is something which I know for a fact, that when you hear the music has magic to it. You know, I think it's the only thing that has magic to it, music. And music, even without words, plain alapana, has huge magic to it. But when the two combine, tune and text, the magic gets multiplied. So when you hear the song which, again, Pradeep has written and Ramachandra has put the music to and Lata Mangeshkar has sung about Hai Mere Pyare Vatan, there is something that resonates to you when she sings Khoon Tha Hindustani. He says Gurkhaya Marathi, Khoon Tha Hindustani. There is something that happens to us, and that would not happen to us if there was not something that was waiting there to happen. It's also true that when we have national disasters, calamities, war, we do get together, we have a sense of nationhood. And thank God, none of you has memories of or rather very fresh memories of war, some of us who have memories of three wars or four wars, would know this, that we do really get together. And it's not artificial. It comes from an aquifer of belonging and relating. So there is that. And it goes back centuries and millennia. What makes your question valid is that this requires a jolt for it to happen. It does not happen normally. We are, in normal times, so to say, extremely abnormal in the way we relate to people, which is why I rather grimly reminded you of these excised portions of two songs, excised and forgotten portions of. Amnesia is our standard mental condition. Collective amnesia is our general condition. But the remembering of our national roots, which are not narrow, is also very real in India. And that is why I'm repeatedly referring to the Constituent Assembly, but they had that vision, and which is why they were called the honest working for the innocent. Innocence has, in a sense, gone. We are no longer an innocent country. But wisdom is a matured version of innocence. If you move from innocence to wisdom, you are continuing crossing over from innocence to wisdom. But we are not innocent anymore, nor are we wise either. There is a truant intelligence which makes us very selfish and which causes more than half the problems we inherit, including what you said about worksite, peer envy, rivalry, and just lack of generosity. Thank you.
I've had to do many votes of thanks before in my life, but this one is a tough one because I didn't want to break the atmosphere you've created so beautifully, and I'm just taking all of this in, but I'd like to thank you, sir, very much for being here. And Pavitra, while you're at it, why don't you do the honors, and we have a small token for you. Thank you very much. I do have a few things to say. I think what you did was, you did give us a jolt, but it's a well-timed jolt. And in terms of crossing over, I think it was a very sophisticated and elegant jolt, not a shabby one at all. The reason these crossover series lectures make a lot of sense for us right now is that we are trying to also in some small way build a nation in the university we are trying to build. And as soon as you talked about the land and the civilization and the values, I could immediately see the connect to what we are trying to do at Ashoka. And it probably is very fortuitous that you talked about the emblem, because, and the fourth lion, because I don't think I'll ever forget the connect between what you said and what we are trying to do. So it's actually very powerful what you said at a time as we are trying to have some big debates within our group about what Ashoka should be. I don't think those debates will ever stop as we are still discussing India so many years later. I also want to say something that I was struck by. I've been called by many names, and in one of your emails back to me, you referred to me suddenly as Pramath Babu. And it actually got me thinking, because I haven't been ever called that. And my father used to be called by Babu all the time. I was thinking, who has ever called me that? And I could only remember my our servant, our family retainer in Patna, who has been with us for as long as I can remember, and he calls me by my nickname and adds Babu to it. Of course, a lot of people call me Pramath Ji now. It's become the easy way out these days, I think, if you want to be a little ethnic. In northern India, people call me Sinha Sahab a lot as I've become grayer and lost some hair. But what happened was that when you wrote that, I was stumped because I didn't know what to call you in response. The first thing that came to mind was obviously Gandhiji. And I sort of chickened out because I wasn't quite sure how you would take that. And then there was Gandhi Sahib and Gandhi Babu, and then that didn't sound right either. So I just left it at sir and chickened out. If I had heard this talk before, I probably would have gone with Gandhiji. Thank you very much for being here. I'd like to thank our, I don't know if I can call him number one or number two, because his wife will probably take offense to it, but our first professor at, one of our first professors at Ashoka University, Professor Jonathan Gill Harris, for doing such a great job of doing the introduction today. Perhaps we can hear about your views on what issues the New Zealanders are debating about their identity. Thank you all to our special guests who are here. Thank you all very much for coming. We do these, of course, for our Young India Fellows, but as much for our outside guests who are here. So we appreciate your making your way through the Delhi traffic on a weekday. I hope you will keep coming. Our next crossover series lecture is by Professor Ruby Lal of Emory University in mid-December. I think it is 12th December, I'm pretty sure. And by Professor Vasudha Dalmia, who is the Indra Nui Professor of Indian Studies at Yale University in January. And we'll get the dates back to you. Thank you very much all for coming, and good night.